Greetings, fellow nerds. A vacuum pump is an optional but extremely useful thing to have in a chemistry lab. You can use it for vacuum filtrations, drying chemicals, and for changing the boiling points of solvents and distillations. This is especially useful if you're boiling chemicals with very high boiling points or getting around azeotropic mixtures. Now, I've shown previously these cheap $6 nylon diaphragm pumps. They're primarily useful for moving gases at atmospheric pressure like in an electrolysis box or for filtration, but they're ineffective for distillations or chemical drying. They are cheap, however, and even if you destroy them with solvent vapors, it's not much of a hassle to buy a replacement. Something a lot more powerful is this aspirator pump. You can purchase these easily online, and I got mine for just $10. You can also get all glass ones for a bit more, but worth it if you're doing a lot of acid distillations. So let's open it up. This is the vacuum port. There is a one-way check valve inside this connector to prevent backflow, but I'll be honest, it doesn't work very well. This is where the vacuum is actually generated. It's just a nozzle inside a tube. That's all it is. First, you send high pressure water through the inlet here on the right, where it reaches this nozzle and becomes a high speed jet at lower pressure. The jet shoots down this tube and, thanks to the Venturi effect, it pulls any gases with it and creates a vacuum. You access the vacuum through this port on the side. It's a tremendously simple device that does indeed do a good job of providing vacuum. It also has the advantage of being very robust to chemicals. To use one, you're going to need a high pressure water pump to feed it. Here's my setup. Now, originally, most amateurs and even most professionals just connected the aspirator to their faucet and ran water through it. Obviously, this was tremendously wasteful in terms of water going down the sink and can be blatantly illegal depending on your local laws, since the water is now mixed with possibly very toxic chemicals. Now, we usually have our own water pump and recycle the water as it's being used. I'm using this 12-volt diaphragm pump to give me 100 psi of water pressure to feed the aspirator. It cost me about $20 online. Now, when this turns on, the pump sucks up water through this inlet tube. It's self-priming, so it doesn't have to be below the water level to start. The pressure is increased to 100 psi inside the pump and forced into the aspirator here. The aspirator starts pumping vacuum now and ejects wastewater through this larger tube and flows back down into the reservoir. You actually don't need this tube at all and can just let the water eject against the side of the bucket. But I find this tube to be cleaner and quieter with less splashing. Let me turn it on to show its operation. And there you go. The great thing about this is that whatever gases are sucked in by vacuum are in turn very well scrubbed by the water. So if you have any reactive gases, you can efficiently remove them from the stream if you add appropriate neutralizing chemicals to the water. I like to use sodium hydroxide for scrubbing most of the gases I encounter. We effectively created both a chemically resistant vacuum pump and a gas scrubber in one. But if you are working with toxic gases or solvents, I still recommend placing this vacuum pump system outside or in a fume hood and leading the tube to where you need your vacuum. The solvents can still evaporate off the reservoir and fill your lab. If the gases don't dissolve fast enough, they'll also end up in your lab. Anyway, let's actually test our vacuum pump. Now, I don't have a chemically resistant vacuum gauge yet, but we can crudely demonstrate as well as measure our vacuum by doing a vacuum distillation. Here I have just water, and it's in a sealed apparatus connected to our aspirator vacuum pump. Let me turn on the pump as well as turn on light heating on the hot plate. Now, at first we're going to see some bubbles and vapor, but that's just because of the change in pressure. Gases dissolved in the water are now coming out and not actually boiling. We'll know we're distilling when we see actual drops of water falling into the receiver. My receiver has a bit of water already because I was running some tests before. Now, all we do is wait. If this works, we should be distilling water at below the normal boiling point of water. Reducing pressure has the effect of lowering the boiling point for all liquids. And look, there it is. We're already distilling water under reduced pressure at just 39 degrees Celsius. That's far below the normal boiling point of water at 100 degrees Celsius. We can actually calculate the pressure based on the boiling point since the properties of water are well known. To boil water at 39 degrees Celsius, the pressure inside the apparatus must be at around 52.5 torr or about 70 millibar. For an amateur setup costing just 50 bucks worth of aspirator pumps, tubing, and a container, we've done pretty well. Now, what limits our ultimate vacuum in this case isn't the design of the system, but the working fluid. The fluid itself has a vapor pressure that starts delivering pressure back into the system as the system pressure goes down. While in theory we should reach the vapor pressure of the water in the reservoir, in practice the pumping rate effectively gets slower and you approach the ultimate vacuum asymptotically. The most effective way of getting around this is not to use water at all, but to use a fluid with an even lower vapor pressure like mineral oil or ethylene glycol. Ultra-low vapor pressure oil, called vacuum pump oil, can also be used. You can also use a gas and avoid the problem completely, but for that you need a gas compressor with a much higher pressure and flow rate to match the performance of a liquid. Now I'm not going to replace my reservoir with oil or ethylene glycol because those are not nearly as cheap and they're quite messy. There is, however, one simple trick for getting even better vapor pressure just with water. We add lots of ice. By lowering the temperature, we lower the vapor pressure of the water. Granted, it's only temporary until the ice melts, but if you have enough ice, it can last you a distillation run. Let's give it a try. Now we're pumping under ice water aspirator vacuum. You'll notice the condenser fogging up because I'm also pumping ice water through it. You can't distill something below room temperature using a coolant that's at room temperature, so I'm pumping ice water. The temperature is going down as we further reduce the pressure, but we won't know how well we're doing until the water actually starts distilling. Now occasionally, the amateur chemist might get the idea of using the aspirator pump reservoir as the condenser coolant reservoir as well. I strongly recommend against this as you'll be pumping whatever contaminated water your aspirator produced through your condenser. Overall, I recommend separate water systems for your condenser and your aspirator. Anyway, there we go. We're now distilling at 28 degrees, quite an improvement from before. And it looks like we're still pumping down and improving the vacuum, so we may get even better numbers as we wait. Now if you go online and look for vacuum pumps, you'll find thousands of better vacuum pumps that can easily reach sub-millibar pressures for very reasonable prices. Most of them are of the rotary vane type. Unfortunately, the major drawback of such pumps is that they can only really handle atmospheric gases like oxygen, nitrogen, argon, and so on. Water vapor and chemical solvent vapors will condense into the oil inside the pump, corroding or wearing the mechanisms. Professional chemists use liquid nitrogen cooled cold traps to trap, condense, and freeze the gases before they reach the pump. Unfortunately, the operating cost for such protection is often out of reach for the amateur. Another approach is to use a diaphragm pump with Teflon or PTFE seals. These seals are chemically inert and thus a PTFE diaphragm pump can take corrosive gases and even pump liquids all the same. Unfortunately, they are rather pricey. Overall, an aspirator pump gives the greatest value if you don't need physics or engineering grade vacuum. Okay, looks like the vacuum has improved considerably. You can see here water is actually getting trapped in the vacuum adapter. The pressure is so low it can no longer push the water through. We've reached 19 degrees Celsius in our distillation. To put this into perspective, it's a hot day and my laboratory is at 30 degrees Celsius. We are boiling water over 10 degrees below ambient temperature. We were able to get this 20 degree improvement from earlier just by adding ice to the reservoir. The calculated pressure to boil water at 19 degrees Celsius is about 16.5 torr or 22 millibar. And that is how you use an aspirator vacuum pump. I hope this video was useful for you. If you would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, please support the channel on Patreon. Links are in the video description.